Hi everyone, this is the lecture to accompany Chapter 3 in your textbook. Please read Chapter 3, there's lots of information I don't have time to address. Okay, let's talk about clear thinking, critical thinking, and clear writing. We've looked at good and bad arguments over the past few months. You'll be starting to create your own arguments in the form of your critical and argumentative essays soon. I hope you're committed to making sure those essays are clear, understandable, and effective. There are, however, several things that stand in the way of clarity when it comes to writing. Those things all have to do with the way in which we use language. We generally use it well enough to get through the day. However, when it comes to good thinking and good writing, we can always use help with clarity. Getting your point across can often be hampered by poor use of language. So we're going to look at things that get in the way of clarity, how important it is to understand and use definitions correctly, and how to write a clear, effective essay. The first way in which we might be misunderstood is because of vagueness. A word or phrase is considered vague if we can't say with certainty what it includes or excludes. Now, sometimes vagueness is deemed necessary so that something can be interpreted in different ways according to existing conditions. For instance, most of the time a speed limit is just that, a speed limit, and a cop can pull you over if you go faster than the posted limit. But what if there's a huge storm and going the posted limit would put you and those around you in danger? Can you still drive at the limit with impunity? Actually, no. Most states have laws about driving too fast for road conditions. While that's absolutely vague, it can be used by a cop to pull you over and give you a ticket during that storm because your driving speed is too dangerous for the conditions. It's meant to be vague, so it can be interpreted by the officer as necessary for the situation. Another example of intentionally vague language for a good reason is the U.S. Constitution. It wasn't meant to be precise, it was meant to be interpreted. Now, how that interpretation should be handled is up for debate. Should lawmakers interpret it as they believe the original writers would, or should they interpret it according to situations in which we find ourselves today? It's an ongoing debate, and not likely to be resolved, probably ever. However, most vagueness isn't done for good reasons, not necessarily bad reasons, although lots of politicians and advertisers are intentionally vague so they don't have to come right out and answer questions. It's mostly unintentional. We simply have a tendency to speak in generalities rather than precisely. Look at these examples. Go down this street a ways until you get to the first major intersection, make a sharp right, then when the street starts to curve to the left, you'll be there. Has anyone ever given you directions like this? It's almost impossible to know exactly what that person means. How far is a ways? What do they mean by a major cross street? Is that one with a stop sign or a light? Thank goodness for Google Maps, right? Your friends are rich. You should hit them up for money. What is rich? Do they mean your friends are literally dripping with cash, or just that they have more money than you do? Don't miss too many classes or it will affect your grade. How many classes is too many? And what does it mean by affecting my grade? It would be good to know those things. Freedom, equality, and the American dream. Those are terms that mean something to Americans, but exactly what to each of us? Politicians will liberally sprinkle these vague terms into their speeches simply because they know they will be interpreted by individuals in a way that satisfies each of those people and can help that politician to appeal to a wider range of potential voters. Ambiguity occurs when someone uses a word or statement that can have more than one meaning and causes confusion because the reader or listener may mistakenly think that the arguer is using one meaning when in fact they mean the other. For example, Paul cashed a check. Okay, nobody uses checks anymore, but you still know what they are. That statement has two separate meanings. The first meaning is that Paul took someone's check and gave them cash in return, or that Paul took a check to a bank and the bank gave him cash for it. Without more context for that statement, you might assume the wrong meaning. The next one, the author of Hamlet might have been a woman. Again, two separate possibilities. Do they mean that somebody other than Shakespeare wrote Hamlet and that author was a woman? Or do they mean that Shakespeare was actually not a man, but instead was a woman? Again, hard to tell. Ambiguity comes in three varieties: semantic, grouping, and syntactic. Let's look at them. Semantics has to do with the meanings of individual words. In semantic, ambiguity It's the meaning of individual words that causes confusion. Here are some examples. Women can fish. The word can has two entirely different meanings that make the sentence have two entirely different meanings. Can means am able to, as in women are able to or have the capability to fish. Can also means the process of putting things inside cans like they do at a cannery. So women can fish could also mean that women work at canneries putting fish inside cans. Again, with no context, this could mean either one. The next example, Charles drew a gun. The word drew has two meanings. It can either mean Charles pulled out a gun or Charles created a picture of a gun. Which one? With no context, I don't know, and you don't either. Grouping ambiguity is a particular kind of semantic ambiguity that occurs when the words you're using make it unclear whether you're referring to individuals or to groups. These examples show how this happens. The first example, administrative assistants make more money than tenured professors do here at CSN, seems to be false on first reading. Tenured professors generally make more money than AAs do, at least individually. But are they talking about individuals or the group of these things as a whole? If you grouped all AAs together, would their combined salary be more than the combined salary of all tenured professors? I actually don't know the answer to that, but you can see how it would be confusing unless you knew what they were talking about, if they were talking about these things individually or as a whole. Here's another one. This is the biggest tax increase in history. When a politician decries a tax increase as the biggest one in history, do they mean as a country or for each taxpayer individually? Will each person be paying more taxes than they ever have before? Or do they mean that the government will collect more tax money than it ever has before? They may be saying it hoping that their audience thinks it's the first one rather than the second one to scare them into thinking they will personally be paying more when that's not actually the case. Then we have syntactic ambiguity. Syntax has to do with the way sentences are structured. The ambiguity occurs when that structure makes the meaning unclear. Here are some examples. The first one, Linda likes candy more than Howard. So does Linda like candy more than she likes Howard? Or does she like candy more than Howard does? Because of the sentence structure, it's hard to tell. The second one, my grandmother heard the salesman with a hearing aid. Did she hear the salesman because she was wearing a hearing aid? Or did she hear the salesman who was the person wearing the hearing aid? Again, it's unclear. Generality refers to a lack of specificity in language. When you're too general, you don't give enough details for the audience to truly understand to what or to whom you're referring. A term that refers to all members of a group is more general than a term that refers to specific members of that group, and it gets more specific as you refer to less and less members of a group until you use language that only applies to a specific member of that group, as in this example that moves from extremely general to individually specific. Mammal. Well, that's obviously the most general term. We could be referring to any mammal. Human. Okay, now we're narrowing it down, but still, any human. Male. Okay, we've narrowed it down to every human male. Russian male. Well, that's a more specific subset. High-ranking Russian governmental male. Okay, now we're getting somewhere, but probably still thousands of people fit that description. Oh, okay, we're talking about Russian President Vladimir Putin, one specific individual. Now, obviously, if you were talking about him, you wouldn't refer to him as just a Russian male with no other identifying language. But it does point out that the more detail you provide, the more likely it is that your meaning will be understood. Vagueness, ambiguity, and generality are obviously closely related. While we will be doing exercises in class to make sure you understand the difference between them, in real life it's more important that you are able to tell when language simply isn't clear enough and ask questions like, "What exactly do you mean by that?" In order for you to be an effective speaker and writer, you need to understand the different purposes and kinds of definitions and to be able to use them well. Definitions are absolutely necessary for clarity, to avoid the kinds of things we just talked about, to make our arguments more clear and distinct. We'll look at three purposes of definitions: lexical, precising or stipulative, and persuasive or rhetorical, and the three different kinds of definitions: definition by example, definition by synonym, and analytical definitions. Purposes of definitions. First, lexical definitions, known also as denotative or dictionary definitions, are very clear definitions of individual words or phrases, such as those that you would find in a dictionary, like this one: tamarin, noun, a small forest-dwelling South American monkey of the marmoset family, typically brightly colored and with tufts and crests of hair around the face and neck. Precising or stipulative definitions are designed to make the term even more precise than a lexical definition, possibly even stipulating precisely what it means in a particular situation. This is often done in scientific or business reports or academic papers, as in these instances. The first one: data, in our case, is raw information collected from survey forms, which is then put in tabular form and analyzed. This one defines the term data to mean a specific thing and not any other meaning you might use in another context. The second one: in this contract, the term dollars will refer exclusively to Canadian dollars. It stipulates that in this contract, they're not referring to any other type of dollars but Canadian. Finally, persuasive or rhetorical definitions. Often people apply their particular feelings, also known as the connotative meanings, about something to words, defining them with particular language to try to persuade you to feel the same way about the issue being discussed. So if you define abortion as the murder of innocent children, your definition includes your opinion about abortion. The next definition: faith is the mechanism by which people are coerced into believing highly unlikely things. This definition of faith is pretty obvious about what the speaker actually thinks about the concept of faith. Now, people don't generally use these kinds of definitions to clarify. They use them to persuade. So you'll see these things a lot in political speech, and they're often used to either trash the opposition or build up positive emotional appeal for their own viewpoint. So while this can be very effective, it's often not particularly ethical. We just talked about the purpose of definitions or why people use them. Now we're going to look at how we define things, the different kinds of definitions. First, there's definition by example. This is also known as ostensive definition. When we use this kind of definition, we might do something as obvious as pointing at the thing we're referring to, as in pointing to the front door and saying, "This is the door where I want you to install the camera." The example here: the walls were green, like a combination of grass and Granny Smith apple green. This person is identifying different examples of things that have the color that this person is talking about. When you define by example, you either show the thing itself or put an image of what you're talking about into the mind of the listener. It's a fairly direct way of defining things. Definition by synonym has to do with language. You define your term by using another word or phrase that has a similar or exact meaning as the one you're defining. "That guy was a charlatan. I mean, he was a total imposter and a fraud." This person is defining the word charlatan by using other words, imposter and fraud, that mean the same thing. Finally, analytical definition, in which you specify the features that something must possess in order for the thing being defined to apply. Most lexical and dictionary definitions fall into this category, as this example. While the legal definition of homeless varies from country to country, it is generally considered to apply to the condition of people without a permanent dwelling, such as a house or apartment. So here are some tips to keep in mind as you start writing your essays. First, while we often use rhetorical or persuasive definitions in our daily lives to get our opinions out there, I recommend against using them in your writing. Even if you have a strong opinion of something, it's often more coercive than reasonable to use these types of definitions. People may be persuaded without even knowing it's happening if they accept a rhetorical definition. I realize that's usually why people use them, to be sneakily persuasive, but your arguments should be sound and strong, not manipulative. Plus, if someone is a good critical thinker who disagrees with your position, they're going to also disagree with your definitions, so you won't be very persuasive. Definitions should be used to increase clarity, to make both your evidence and your conclusions more understandable. Remember, don't define things in a way that makes them more obscure, and definitely don't define them in emotional terms. Finally, while you can do your best to define terms to make their meaning clear, you may need to get along with definitions that are incomplete. If you try to spend your time defining terms that in and of themselves are general, like friendship or justice, you'll spend all your time doing that and not have any left over for your actual arguments. Do your best to use clear language and good, clear definitions. This is the end of part one. Please move on to part two.